Hello, and welcome to the second video in Penn Future's data center series, Inside a Data Center. If you have not already seen our first video, What is a Data Center? We invite you to go check that out. There we go. Okay. Before we get started, a little bit about me. My name is Bridget Meyer, and I'm a staff attorney in Penn Future's Pocono office. Penn Future is a member-supported nonprofit environmental organization that strives to protect Pennsylvania's air, water, and land, and to empower citizens to build sustainable communities for future generations. My work at Penn Future focuses primarily on land use and water quality, and prior to joining Penn Future, I was an associate attorney at a law firm in Chester County, where my work focused on municipal and land use law. So today we are going to talk about what goes on inside a data center. As I mentioned a minute ago, we have a previous video that talks about what a data center is and different types of data centers. So if you're interested in that, go back and check that out. But today we're going to talk about what happens inside a data center. There is a caveat here that there is a lot of variation between data centers. So this is a very general overview, and there will be a significant amount of variation from data center to data center. So the first main thing that is part of almost all data centers, the thing that is what makes a data center, is the server hall. We talked in the previous video about servers and what they are, what they do. So the server hall is the part of the data center where all the servers are. They are arranged in what are called racks or cabinets. So you can see these sort of boxes that are full of servers. And when we are in co-location facilities, the certain racks may be within cages so that one tenant of the data center cannot access another tenant's equipment. Just to see what this might look like in real life, there it is. There are all your racks of servers. As you can tell, it's basically just cabinets full of wires and lights and computer things. The next part of a data center is the cooling system, and this could actually take up about the same amount of space, if not more, than the server hall itself. The cooling system is a vital part of the data center because this is what removes the hot air generated by the equipment in the server hall to prevent overheating and loss of function. And the ability to cool the data center is actually part of what drives the data center's size. It can't be any bigger than what you can cool. There are a number of different ways that cooling can happen in a data center. Main types are water cooled and air cooled, and then there's also free cooling, which is essentially just using fans to draw air from the outside into the data center without any other kind of cooling. So here's a quick overview of a water cooled chiller system. In this kind of system, you would have in the server room something called a computer room air conditioner or computer room air handler, and this blows air around, circulates air around the server room. It draws warm air from the servers into the unit, and that comes into contact with a bunch of pipes that are filled with water. The water then flows into what is called a chiller, and inside the chiller, there is a refrigerant cycle similar to your air conditioner at home. The refrigerant transfers the heat from this loop of water into a second, separate loop of water, and that loop of water then carries the water outside of the building to the cooling tower. The warm water is then sprayed out inside this cooling tower across a filler that's inside there. And fans blow air across the water, cooling it. Some of the water gets evaporated, the rest gets cooled off and returned down into this loop, which then goes back into the building and back to the chiller where it can pick up more heat. After the heat from the first loop is removed by this whole cycle, it circulates back into the server room, and the air that is blown across it is cooled off, and then that circulates back into the server room to cool off the servers. In this type of system, a fair amount of water is evaporated during the part where it's in the water tower, so new water has to be added pretty constantly to make up for the water that is lost through evaporation. And we have on our next slide a short video, segment of a video that is a tour of a data center, just to show just how much of a building this cooling system can take up.
That hot water comes over to the centrifugal chillers here, which then exchanges that heat and concentrates it to the evaporation system and the cooling towers. So, for an idea of scale, your normal residential air conditioning unit for a house is usually anywhere from 3 to 5 tons. Each one of these green units here is 1,050.
So you can see here that the chillers, that there's typically not just one chiller in a building. There will be many chillers depending on the size of the building, often with redundancy, so that if one chiller stops working for some reason, there's a backup to pick up that function. Another type of air system for cooling would be an air-cooled chiller. This is similar, except it does not have the second loop where the heat is transferred into the water. So, similar to a water-cooled system, there's a computer room air conditioner or air handler that takes the heat from the server room, transfers it to this loop full of water. It is then moves to a chiller that is typically located outside of the building, and it is transferred to the refrigerant cycle, like in the water-cooled system. Except here, instead of the refrigerant cycle transferring the heat to another loop full of water, the refrigerant is then moved through these condenser coils that are similar to what you would have in an air conditioner in your house. And there are a whole bunch of them there inside this condenser unit here. And there are fans that blow air across these coils and remove the heat. So the refrigerant itself gets cooled down by the air, then it gets returned here into this part, the chiller, and it cools off the water, and the water goes back down into the computer room air handler or air conditioner, where the air blowing across it is cooled, and it returns cool air to the server room. I don't have a video of that, sorry. So the next thing that you will find in a data center are generators. Generators are typically not the main power supply for a data center. They are a form of backup power in case the main power supply is interrupted. As we talked about in our first video, uninterrupted power supply is one of the main reasons that data centers exist. They have a bunch of redundancy so that if something happens to the power, there's a backup so that you never lose power. So the generators are part of this. Again, redundancy is the name of the game, so you would not have just enough generators to run the data center. Usually there are enough generators and then some in case something happens to one or more of the generators. The generators are typically fueled by diesel or natural gas, and they'll activate automatically when they detect an interruption of power from the main power supply. So here's another clip from that same video showing what a generator might look like inside a data center.
What we're looking at is the diesel generator backbone to a data center. So power goes out. This is ultimately what kicks on to be able to provide power for the building. In this situation, you have the cold air will come in from this side of the building, goes through, gets sucked through the radiator, and then out the louvers on the backside. That will all automatically open up at the point that these things are requested to turn on. And again, these things go from sitting still, not on, to full 60 mile an hour, ear bleeding rough, in about 16
Like
seconds.
if these come. So in that video, you can see that the generators are located inside the building. Often generators are also located outside the building in these kind of shipping container type boxes. Next thing that you would find in a data center is something called the Uninterrupted Power Supply, or UPS. Excuse me. The UPS is basically a giant battery. And if you remember from that video, the man said that if the power goes out, it takes about 16 seconds for the generators to kick on. The UPS is what supplies power during that 16-second period. So however long it takes between loss of main power and generators, this is what supplies power during that little gap. Here's a picture of lithium-ion CPS at a data center facility in Chicago. And these are important to know about because, due to the lithium-ion aspect of it, there are concerns around fire suppression, and there's special training that fire departments might need to learn how to put out a fire if one of these catches on fire. Next, we have something called the Meet Me Room, or MMR. This is basically where the data center connects to the outside world. All of the cables for internet, phone, etc., power, it all enters into the building here and is then connected and then spread out to the server room and other parts of the data center from here. So this is the hub or the interconnection point for all the different parts of the data center. Now, moving to outside the data center, some things you might find on the outside of the building. You might see, if you have a water-cooled system, water towers to store water for that cooling system, and towers might also provide some degree of cooling if it is cooler outside than inside the building. You might also see the cooling towers that we talked about for the water-cooled system, or if it's an air-cooled system, you would see the air handlers outside. So that's what those look like. And then again, you might see generators on the outside of the building. Often data centers also have substations, which serve the same function as any other substation. They connect the data center to the power grid and step down the voltage from the grid so that it is usable inside the facility. Some data centers also use on-site electric generation, and that can be in the form of wind, natural gas, or solar. Sometimes this is used in conjunction with connection to the power grid or instead of that. So, depending on the data center, you might see some of this also happening on the outside. So, that wraps up this video. We will be sharing other videos. We've already released What is a Data Center? And we will also be releasing soon videos on data center water and power usage, what municipalities can do to prepare for data centers, and also the economic impacts of data centers. So thanks for watching today, and stay tuned for more from Penn Future.